Hello, everyone. Laura Brandenburg here from Bridging the Gap, and super excited to be with you here today. Bit of a different backdrop. I am trying to make things work. We are, as you might have seen, evacuated from the coast due to Hurricane Dorian, and we are safe and sound in Raleigh and doing great. And I had a great morning and early afternoon with my girls. We got to go to a new museum and have a bunch of fun. And so we're doing great and keeping our spirits up. And hopefully this storm has way less impact on us than it has had in other parts of the world. So it's definitely been significant elsewhere. So grateful to be safe and sound. And if you're just joining us, feel free to say hello, let me know your name, where you're from, any questions that you have about the free training that we've offered so far. And as people start to join us, I always like to share a story, and I'm kind of looking over this way because that's out our hotel room window. And this is not the best part about this hotel. We have a beautiful hotel room, but like looking out the window, they're building an apartment complex over there. So like all day there's like machines and workers yelling to one another and all kinds of things going on. But one of the beautiful things about it as it relates to what we're going to talk about today is that we're like, you can see into the building. So it's in a building, it's a building that like the exterior is all built and you can see into like the steel beams and stuff, but like it's not nearly like there's not finished apartments or walls or anything yet. So you kind of get to see under the hood, like an area of a building that you don't normally see. And it really like it relates to what we do as business analysts, right? Because we're like defining what that end product looks like. As a business analyst, we're not probably like defining, sorry, I keep looking over there, as if I look, you can see it, right? We're not defining what that architecture, the system solution has to look like to deliver on those needs. And so it's really interesting though. Sometimes it's fun to kind of see what's going on under the hood and understand how technology is actually put together. And when we work on a certain technology for a while, we often learn that, and then we can kind of start to see how business solutions might be solved by the technology we have, and we can become even more effective and efficient in our requirements. But it can also skew our thinking, where we're starting to think solution design too quickly. So a building metaphor is a perfect metaphor for business analysis. And look, oh, all kinds of wonderful people. So Priyanka, hi Priyanka, I've got your question in my notes. Ant or Anthony from sunny, hot Southern California. Welcome. It's actually really warm here as well, still in the 80s. Ron is joining from Scotland. Rana from Toronto. Hi, Rana. I was just in Toronto a couple weeks ago. It was beautiful. And Sharika from Sri Lanka. We have what? Four countries represented. That's amazing. So welcome everyone. And I'm just going to kind of set the stage for what we're going to talk about today. And I have questions that I've received through email, through the comments on the posts or the video training so far, and pulled a few that have come up in the group that I'm going to make sure to talk about. But I'm also here to answer any questions that you have specifically. So feel free to put those into the comments box either as we go, or if you've got one now, feel free to drop it in as well. But what part we're talking about, or what we're focusing on in the free training right now, is our third part of the free training where we go through the key skills, or really the techniques that you need to know to be successful as a business analyst. And for those of you who are more experienced as a business analyst, the way that these skills become really important is thinking about how do I avoid missing requirements, like by looking at my requirements from multiple different perspectives and not just getting a blinder view. And for those of you who aren't yet business analysts or might be relatively new, looking at the set of techniques that you should be relatively fluent in to consider yourself a quote unquote official business analyst on a software type of project. Okay, and so we cover those skills in quite a bit of depth in part three. And there's a lot of benefits to having both the business view, the software view, and the information view. One thing is, like, if you come from more of a business background, getting that software and information view is like what I was talking about with the building, right? Being able to have a conversation with the equivalent of the construction worker or the building foreman on the software development team about what the end result is, what that software needs to do in an effective way without having to understand what's behind every wall or what the technology looks like or how it's actually coded or how to write or read code. And if you are from a technical background, the techniques give you the different perspective. They give you the more business-focused perspective, like how to ask the right questions from the business stakeholders before you get built, absorbed in how to build the solution, right? And so in a previous coaching session, I think I shared a little bit about Michael Rodriguez's story, and he had a deep technical background when he found our program. What he found is that he called it second and third order questions. And as he moved up in his technical career, he actually had a manager really coach him to ask deeper level questions, which means, you know, don't just start with like, what do we need the software to do? Or even like, how should this be built or configured? But what problem are we solving here? How does this fit into your business process? What if we had this software feature, what would that enable for you? So just able to kind of drill in and have better conversations with business stakeholders as well. All right, we've also got Charmy here from India. So now I think we officially have 5 countries represented. Welcome, welcome. So that's what we're going to talk about today is those techniques, how they're relevant to different people in different professions and some of the questions that we've had come up about that. So I'd love to hear from you before we dive in, who has had a chance to actually go through the third part of the free training? Because I can do a bit of a crash course on that if we need to, if you haven't yet. So if you just leave a yes or no in the box and both answers are okay, no problem. While you're doing that, I'm going to drop a link to the free training here so that if you haven't gone through it yet, you can do that. All right. No, no, not yet. Okay. All right, a couple of no's, a lot of no's. All right, well, I'll do a bit of a crash course. So thank you for your honesty. I love it, I love honesty. So some have done part one and part two, or I'm on part two. Okay, so part three, you do wanna make some time to go through part three because I can speak to it here, but I can't share, there's visuals that are actually shared in part three of each of the techniques. So part two was business process analysis and how to use business process even when you are not in an official BA role. In part three, we go through in a bit more detail around use cases and wireframes. So use cases are the step-by-step interaction for a user interacting with a system. So not, again, what that system is doing under the hood, but if you would picture an ordering system like Amazon, you know, I go in, I can search for XYZ items. This is how the system matches the search, right? Like this is how, if I put in books by Brené Brown, this is how it determines what that algorithm, or what the match is, what displays back to me when I search, what I can do, what I can click on, what I can see, what actions I can take to order that book or read a synopsis of that book. Actually, what I just described there would probably be 3 or 4 different use cases because you do want to break them up a little bit. But that's the kind of functionality that we would talk about in a use case. And then a wireframe would be, I'm like, wireframe, because I draw it out a lot on paper when I do it, but a wireframe would be a visual model of what the screen might look like as I go to do that ordering process. So again, it doesn't have to be very high fidelity, but just a visual of here are the things that I would see on the screen, and I'd have a cover image here and some information here, and this would be hyperlinked so that I could click on it to get more information, and that would be a wireframe. And we accompany those in the blueprint with user stories, which is how we break apart requirements in an agile software development environment, and also now I've got to remember the blueprint on the top of my head. Validation. So it's really important not to just, like, we don't make this up as VAs, like how this stuff should work and what the screens should look like. We are communicating with stakeholders every step of the way. And a really important technique that we use cases and wireframes for is actually validating with our stakeholders that this is what they want before somebody goes to build it. Saves us a lot of time and a lot of money by validating that ahead of time. So that's the use cases and wireframes aspect, the software level, so to speak. And then the next level of the blueprint is the information level. So this is data modeling. How do we organize data? How do we store data in our organization? And the key business technique there is the glossary, which is what are the terms that we use in our organization? So what does customer mean? What does participant mean? What does order mean? What does product mean in an online ordering environment? Like what constitutes a product would be some examples of what you would put in your glossary. And then you organize your glossary into an entity relationship diagram, which is a visual model that shows how your concepts relate to one another. So for example, as a customer, I can submit one order, and that order might have one product or it might have five products. Right, and so we would show the relationship between an order and a product. And then within each of those entities or concepts, we could have many, many pieces of information that we record about that. So like a product would have a product name and a price and maybe a discount rule, product description, right? All kinds of information. And so our data dictionary would show for each concept, what are the specific pieces of information that we can store about this entity. And then the data map is the next one. And that comes into play when we're either moving data from one system to another. Well, it's always when we're moving data from one system to another, but we move data in different circumstances. So sometimes we do a one-time move, right? So we are migrating our system to another system and we have to get all or some of that data into that new system, which means we need to map field by field. Is this product name? Maybe product is in our first system and the other system, I don't know, calls it only books or calls it items or something like that. So is item name the same as product name? Are the rules the same? Like maybe one, you know, we could have up to 50 characters, but they have a limit of 30 characters in the new system. What are we going to do with those 20 extra characters? And so we're making decisions of how data maps back and forth between one system and the other. The easier situation is when we're migrating data from one system to another just one time. The more complex or really just more you need to pay more attention to some of the details even is when we are automating that in real time. So if I order something through Amazon and it's getting passed to a third party reseller or a third party shipment facility, what information is going and what fields are mapping back and forth between those two systems. And then we also cover system context diagrams in data modeling. So that is, you know, you have a core system and then how does data flow between different systems? It's a great tool to show what's in and out of scope for a project. So are we touching the integration between these two systems or are we not? And just looking at it at a very big picture level. So it's a crash course on what we cover in that free training or third part three. If you haven't checked it out yet, you still definitely want to do so because I actually have some visuals in there where I show you quickly examples of what all of those look like so that it's not just words. Some of those things are a little hard to describe in words. So let's talk about some of the questions. And if you have any questions on what I just covered, feel free to put those in the comment box. So the first one was from an MIS student who said, this one we received via email, I'm still an undergraduate student and I'm majoring in management information systems, but I'm interested in the business analysis and I watch online tutorials and I like your videos, it was so helpful. Do you have any advice for me as an undergraduate MIS student? And then we also had Savannah in the group who is in an MIS program and wanted to use these resources that we've been giving to land her first internship. So that makes perfect sense. So what advice do I have in general for students? And One of the things, so there is, when you think about entry-level business analyst roles, there's always like a small segment of companies in any, just about any major local metropolitan area that would hire an entry-level just out of college business analyst. So with the training and in like an MIS degree. So definitely work with your local area, your universities to be familiar with what those organizations are and what those opportunities are, and make sure you're taking whatever courses and training that they would want you to have. But above and beyond that, like what we really see people getting hired for in a BA role, and especially for those of you who are already have some professional experience, is your experience. So anything you can do to get into a professional office setting is really critical, even at a college level. So even if it's kind of administrative work, there's just something that happens when you see how offices run and when you get to experience how they run, that you are going to pick up information about, oh, look, like here we are doing the same thing again and again, and this process is a little broken, right? And start applying some of the things like we've talked about applying, especially the business process, and look for ways to apply that creatively in your work as well. So take the internship just to kind of get your foot in the door. Especially if you can get on a project, like in any sort of role, as any part of any sort of change or project kind of work, that would be ideal. But even administrative work in a department or a business department or an IT department would give you at least the flavor of this is how offices run, this is how people communicate, and these are the challenges people have. And so just to give you things that you can start to speak through in an interview and can use as part of your interviewing experience when you get out of college. So that would be my additional advice for you. And so, if you do have a chance for an internship, see if you can get assigned to some sort of project or change work, and that will take that to the next level. Okay. And then Phil asked, what is the best way to gather requirements? Should I do it in Excel? So I have a lot to say on this one, actually. So, like, the best way to gather requirements is what is going to work best in your organization. And I know that sounds a little bit, and Hussein, was that your question? Because I just had this, like, I'm going to forget his question again, but I'm hoping that that was your question. If not, feel free to get your question in to make sure I get it. So while I'm doing that, requirements. So I know that sounds a little bit like cheating, but it really, like, the way that we organize our requirements and gather our requirements and the tools we use for that, it really is one of those things that has to fit in with how our organization does work, what our organization's processes are, what their methodologies are. Excuse me. So some organizations use Excel, others use Word, others use requirements management tools like Requisite Pro as an example, others use more agile software development tools like Jira or Team Foundation Server and Confluence, right? So that often is not going to be our decision as the BA to decide where the requirements go. So that's really, it's just we got to fit in that degree. But there's really more to requirements gathering though than like where the requirements are stored. So really you can use Excel, and some of our templates are in Excel. So when I shared some of the techniques that I covered, the data dictionaries in Excel, the data maps in Excel, we give a template for the glossary in Word and also Excel. But many of the other ones are in Word. So like a use case is a Word document. A business process template, which you have if you went through the free training, that's a Word document. The glossary primarily is a Word document. And then the other ones are actually visual models. So they're not in Word or Excel. They're often in Visio. So like the process flow diagram or workflow diagram is Visio. An entity relationship diagram that I described, that's Visio. That doesn't fit into Word or Excel. Like you need a visual modeling tool to create one of those. And the wireframes often in Balsamiq or Lucidcharts or Azure is another one that you can use to create wireframes. So lots of lots of different tools that you might use as a business analyst. You don't want to get hung up on one tool being the best tools. And the other thing I want to say is, like, all of these tools, they're really just how the requirements are stored, which is really like 10% of the work that we do as VAs. So where really the magic happens is in the analysis process that we use. How do we figure out what to put in our Excel template? Like, you could have the best Excel template in the world. What do you actually put in it? Like, if you're sitting down and staring at a blank template and you're like, okay, well, now I got to write my software requirements. All right, where do I start now? So where does that go, right? So really, like, it's the brilliance and the genius in business analysis is the discovery, the analysis, and the communication and validation of those requirements. That's where and then we store them and communicate them and kind of get those organized in whatever way is going to work with the team. But what we really need to be experts at in the gathering process is the discovery part. And so some of those techniques, like especially the ones that are captured in Word documents, like, it's not just about what are the sections of the template that's important. It's actually about what is the syntax of how I put information into these templates? What thinking does that force me to do? And what questions does that force me to ask that help me discover requirements and information I didn't even know to look for? And that's the brilliance of using an analytical tool of some sort, like a use case or a business process model. And the same thing happens with some of those visual models. So when you start putting together a wireframe, it's like, okay, well, what does happen when I click that button? Like, oh, we don't have a requirement for that. Or how does a customer relate to an order? What happens if I have more than one order or more than one product, right? Like, do I need more than one order to do for each product? Like, how do these things relate to each other? And it creates questions, and it's the way that we bring our business analysis leadership to an organization to really ask powerful questions. So there's more to the techniques than just the tools that we use to create them. And when on this topic, I really did want to share Manzoli's story. So he wanted to make sure, like, Manzoli came from more of a business background, so didn't have the technical background that, you know, he came from a subject matter expert role into a business analyst role within that area of subject matter expertise. And so he was really good in his specific area. And part of the reason he wanted to learn to use these tools at the next level, or these techniques, really, not, I'm kind of misusing tools there. I use tools sometimes when I really mean techniques, right? So he wanted to use these techniques was so that he could make sure that even in a new domain, even when he was less familiar with the subject matter, that he would still be able to discover, analyze, and validate the requirements as an expert business analyst. And so after he went through learning these tools and getting instructor feedback and some coaching on how to apply them, then he really got to that next level of thinking and had that next level of confidence, and which led to his senior, to interviewing for a new role in a new domain that was actually a senior level business analyst role. Okay, so Adeleke asks, how do you document and decompose a business requirement into a non-functional and functional requirement? Great question. So, you know, people, here's a challenge. You're going to find, if you Google business requirements, you'll find lots of different interpretations of what that actually is. So some people use it to talk about, like, what's the business need or business problem or benefit, like, we're going to improve our sales process by X percent, or our sales efficiency, or how long it takes to do this by a certain percent, which would be like a benefit of the project. Some people use it to talk about, like, a really high level project or requirement, like make improvements to the ordering process, maybe with some more specificity. I actually don't separately document business requirements. So we teach in our BA Essentials Masterclass how to create a scope statement that has the system context diagram to show the scope and a list of the key features, what the benefits are. That is like your container for the project. And then we teach how to analyze the business process. So what are the current state processes? What do we want the to-be processes to be? And it's much easier to decompose business processes into functional requirements than like line item business requirements. So that would be my suggestion. If you do have a practice in your organization where you're documenting those business requirements, and now you're like, well, what is the software requirement or the functional requirement that goes along with that? I also use those two terms are pretty interchangeable as well, software requirement or functional requirement, for those of you kind of new to the terminology in business analysis, which is totally fine. So now, in order to achieve this desired business process, what do we need the software to do for us? And so that becomes a much more specific question, and it's also contextualized in a way that your business stakeholders can often understand. So that's how I would decompose it. Look at what are the business processes related to these business requirements, do a little bit of analysis around those, and then figure out what the software requirements are to support those. And then the non-functional piece, that often comes directly from things like data integrity, like other questions that you would ask in a scope type area or scope kind of question, like data integrity, turnaround time, system response time, things like that. Okay, Savannah said, thanks. I was actually thinking of an administrative role would be a good starting point. Yeah, that's great. You know, you can start there and ask questions, right? And you will prove yourself to be curious, problem solving, question asker, kind of always, you know, look at your administrative role and then try to look, you know, the step ahead and the step behind, look a little bit bigger picture than the role that you get slotted into when you start, and you'll be on your way to solving bigger picture problems as well. Awesome. All right. So next question we had, actually it was a reflection I wanted to share from Yvette. So Yvette, this is just such a beautiful story. And I think this comment just came in last night, and so I didn't share it in my live yesterday. So Yvette said, thank you for these tutorials, very helpful. I'm an office manager for a behavioral health clinic, and I've worked in this particular capacity for about 3 years, but I've spent almost 8 years performing administrative work for various nonprofit agencies. As I'm currently studying to be a master level social worker performing administration and leadership functions, I found that the techniques you spoke about have a unique place in my role here. However, I'm hoping to take my current skill to the next level. So just another example for you, Savannah, of like how that administrative work can lead to business analysis, especially as you start to get into that leadership role in an organization. If you are a manager of a department of people who are executing on specific processes, you're probably in charge of improving those processes and understanding what they are and making sure people are doing work the same way. And so you can use these skills that you're learning to really improve the processes in your own organization as part of the leadership role. You might also be assigned as the subject matter expert on a software project for software that's going to impact your department. And you can use some of the skills that we're teaching in the third part to really help understand the questions that you should be asking and the information that you should be bringing to those discussions with your software development team that will make you a much more informed and strong and capable subject matter expert on those projects and more likely to get what will serve your team really well as well. So all kinds of opportunities, and I just loved how she was sharing how the skills were showing up for her and what most of us would think of as kind of something relatively far away from a business analyst role. Okay, let's see. So Alexander asked about free software. And this one holds people back. So Alexander's questions, you know, thank you for your experience through these three lessons. Are there any free software options that you can recommend for wireframe design? I currently use Pencil. What free software would you recommend for the design of business processes? I currently use BizAG model, and I know there's another software called Appian, but it's not a free software. And something, okay, so best free software, this is again a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but it's not, it's pen and paper. So when you're drawing wireframes and you're drawing business process models, like, it's okay to do it on pen and paper and or on paper or even pencil and paper so you can erase. Whiteboard drawings are great ways to capture visual models. And I know that sounds a little bit like, well, Laura, that's not what I was asking. I want a tool. And there are reasons that it can be really important to capture documentation in electronic formats. It makes it easier to edit and easier to manage long term if it's an asset you're going to use for a long time. But if it's a document that you might just use for a couple of months as part of a project and then it's going to get thrown away and you're going to use something else, like, keep it as easy to create and manage as possible. So don't overlook those tools as options. And then from a free perspective, Balsamiq, that we recommend often in our courses, has a free trial that allows you to create like one wireframe at a time. It takes a little bit of extra time when you use just their free trial, but it does allow you to at least get familiar with the tool. And then I think Balsamiq is like less than $100. So if, sometimes it just makes sense to get the license. So it's a relatively affordable tool. And then we also recommend Lucidcharts for business process models and workflow diagrams and ERDs. And Lucidcharts, one of the nice things about that is you can upload Visio files directly into Lucidcharts, and we provide swipe files of Lucid. Every time we provide swipe files, it's in a Visio format, and so it's nice that you can upload that right into Lucidcharts. And then that provides a free trial that's pretty robust as well. It's up to, I think, 5 models that you can store, and up to something like 60 or 70 elements per model. So there's a certain sense of scope, like you can't go too big, like you can't draw one of those monster diagrams. But as we teach anyways, like those monster diagrams, nobody can see the whole thing and it's way too much information. So it actually helps you stay in a narrow focus. So those are just some other options that I would recommend. And if you have a great tool that you like to use, that would be great to see in the comments too. Oh, and the other thing I wanted to mention on tools that even Visio has a 60-day free trial. So Visio is probably the most standard tool out there, like the most frequently used tool. The web-based tools like Lucidcharts, oh, and the other one is Gliffy that comes with a pretty good free trial. Those works very similarly. So like once you understand the concept of how to put that model together, like how to put an ERD together, how to put a workflow diagram together, like, and then if you've done it in Lucidcharts and then your organization is using Visio, like you've learned the 95%. And then there's like this 5% of like, okay, what are the nuances of Visio that I need to do? And often then you can just use Google to like figure that out or YouTube, right? Like there'll be some tutorial videos or something that you can use if it's not intuitive to figure out, or there'll be somebody in your department who can help you with that little 5%. It's how you put that model together structurally that is really the key learning that you can bring with you, no matter what tool you're using. Okay, Jennifer Miller says, "Hey Jennifer, thank you so much for your videos and content on your site. This has helped me tremendously during my BA job interviews, and I recently moved into a BA role after 12 years in finance. Congratulations! What advice would you give me to be successful in my new career path as I'm a bit overwhelmed in the first few weeks?" Oh, and I think I'm so glad you're here because I think I had your question down in a bit, but we will talk about it now. So super excited. So excited for you to be moving into a BA role. And I think the biggest thing is that like take some time in that role. There's two things. One, the expectations of a business analyst are often unclear. So you recently moved into that role. Set like there's they may not even know how to explain to you what to do as a business analyst, right? So the overwhelm could be on both sides. Like you might feel overwhelmed because there's so much ambiguity about your role, and they might be overwhelmed because, especially if it's a new role for them, like they haven't had a BA before. They may be like, "We're actually not sure how to make this BA successful," right? So there could be overwhelm on both sides, and also a need to clarify expectations on both sides, and that's okay. So the way that you need to show up in response to that is making sure you're setting expectations. Like, I've been asked to do this. Let me, all right, my understanding is this. giving them a very early draft of whatever it is that you're working on, getting feedback early and often, being open to feedback, being open to interpretations, like the best practice for how to write a use case is this. This is what I've learned, but how do you use them in this organization, right? So just really making sure that you're setting those expectations, open to feedback, having a conversation around what those roles are. And the other thing I would say is just focus at first on a quick win. So what is the big reason that they hired you? Is there a project? Is there, what is it? Like, what's the urgency? And make sure that you create a quick win for your organization, for yourself and your career. And kind of like there can be all this clutter of like, oh, I should be doing this and this and this and this and this, which are all things that you can bring to your organization eventually, right? But maybe like a lot of times this happens, like they hire a VA, but they're already in the testing phase, right? And they really just need you to jump in and test something. And you're like, well, this isn't really what a VA is supposed to do. And people can get really frustrated about that. And I understand it, I appreciate it. But like a lot of times, especially in your first role, like the most important thing is that you are productive and creating value in that organization. And then once you have that track record of creating value in that organization, then you can be like, you know, there's more to business analysis than doing the testing. And I'd be able to make a much bigger impact if I was involved earlier in the project and starting to analyze some of these processes and figure out what the requirements are. And so you back into some of those bigger picture roles. So just look at like, what did they hire you for? What do they need the most? And make sure you're delivering on that and use that to get out of the overwhelm, right? You don't have to do all the things in your first couple of months, but you do want to make sure you're delivering some value because that's what will keep you around for the next few months. And I don't say that to like, you know, to worry you or anything, but you do want to just make sure you're kind of getting to whatever that core problem that they need to have solved is, because that's what keeps you sticky. All right, sticky in a good way, not sticky like peanut butter on the floor. All right, great question. Priyanka, one thing I have found is increasingly difficult during my past BSA, which I'm business systems analyst role, is that during our stakeholders requirements gathering meeting, the discussions amongst the leaders go so fast that sometimes it becomes so hard to even interrupt them to ask questions in between. So please help in this case. How should I as the BSA capture all the needed details during that ongoing discussion? And I even miss it sometimes, which surely makes me nervous. Great question. And this is a huge, huge issue for business analysts. And when you say the leaders, I guess usually it's you're probably working with managers, right, in terms of what the requirements need to be or what the processes need to be for their organization. So I would challenge you to look at, is everybody in that organization or everybody in that meeting truly contributing? So often, even the fast-paced conversations, you might have two or three people contributing, but there's probably another two or three people who are not contributing. And what that means is the discussion is going too fast for them as well. Okay? And so when you slow the conversation down, which I'm consciously doing now, I like to talk fast as well. I can kind of get, you slow the conversation down and you ask the questions. And you ask just starting with clarifying questions like, oh, I heard you use this term. Could you just, you know, I just want to make sure that we're all understanding what that means and how that affects the project. Or I heard you talk about this problem. Can we just clarify how that affects what we're doing here? And so use your active paraphrasing skills and you're really just paying attention in those meetings to making sure you understand what's been said, okay? But you got to slow the conversation down and you have to insert yourself to ask those questions. And the other thing that you can do is if it is fast and furious and you really can't even interrupt, right? Is okay, let it go fast and furious, and then there's going to be a pause at some point, or there's going to be the end of the meeting where if you're leading the meeting, it's your job to say, okay, what I heard is this, this, and this, and my next step is to create this requirements model. Like, I'm going to take everything I heard from the discussion and I'm going to draft a business process that I think reflects what has been shared here. And I'm going to schedule a follow-up to review it and make sure that we're really all on the same page of what this process is. Now, then, that meeting, you have a little bit more leverage because you are running the show. And so if you're not doing those sorts of meetings now, you really do want to jump forward to scheduling a meeting where you're bringing a business analysis deliverable to the gate, to the plate, and you're bringing that to the meeting with the purposes of validating it and stepping through it. And so then you have more of a domain in a way to stop the discussion and be like, right now in this meeting, we're focused on making sure this business process is correct. So can you make sure, like, when you're sharing that, how does it relate back to this, right? And you're using your leadership skills to get everyone on the same page. And so you're using these tools to help you facilitate those discussions. So it is hard, and it takes some courage. It's not hard in the sense that, like, it's hard to do. It's hard in the sense that it, like, makes us, like, what are people gonna think if I'm the one who says I don't understand, or if I'm the one who has questions? But what happens if you just kind of let these conversations kind of stay up in the air, you know, fast-paced conversation, blah, 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 yeah, everybody thinks, like, things are moving, and then it's like you go forward a week and you're back in that meeting, it's like the same conversation again, right? Because it's up here and nobody's bringing it down here. And down here would be like confirming the requirements, thinking through the details, making sure everybody's on the same page. And so you need to bring that conversation in to make sure that everybody is really on the same page. And just because they're going fast does not mean that they understand each other. And if you are having that repetitive cycle of like one discussion, like it's the same discussion, they're definitely not understanding each other. Okay. And so you can create tremendous efficiency and actually make things go faster on your projects when you slow those individual conversations down, because you'll actually be getting clarity and you'll be getting everybody on the same page. Great question. Okay. One other thing I just want to say on this is some VAs like resort to recording the conversation, and that's not my favorite practice, because I think it allows us, it gives us an escape route. Like, oh, I didn't hear that. I can just catch it on the recording. And then you catch it on the recording and you're like, oh, it still didn't make sense, right? I still have another question. And so you're still in the same cycle. So definitely, definitely use the tools and the communication techniques to help you in that situation. Okay. All right. Similar question as we had before was from Latonia. I hope I'm saying your name right. And she was saying she's currently coming in completing her master's degree in system engineering and completing my bachelor in IT systems with a concentration in IT project management. And I've been an IT manager for the government focusing on customer relationship management and recently got placed in the role of business analyst. It's been a struggle because it's not necessarily a position held by government employees, and I've not had the opportunity to have on-the-job training with little direction or guidance from the government. Sorry, from management, any help or ideas? So in addition to what I shared previously about starting a new role, you are gonna have to propose, something. So look at why you were hired, what problem is being solved by you being involved, and make sure that, what is the BA approach in that case? So do they need a business case? Do they need a scope statement? Do they need their processes analyzed? Are you already kind of through that and you need use cases, right? What is the next step? And you propose that and you share why you're proposing that. So I see us having this pain point. This deliverable is going to help us get to the next step. So I'm going to go do this. What do you think? What are your reactions? What does this match with your expectations of what you want, hope that I would achieve? And so you throw that back to them to manage those expectations. But you will have to come to them if they're not familiar with working with a VA. You will have to come to them with some sort of an approach that they can either say yes or no to. Very much like we use wireframes for our business stakeholders to say, hey, here's what I'm thinking this system might look like. And what is this what you were thinking? Yes or no? And you get a much better response to that with a wireframe than you do if you ask them to read like a list of 20 requirements, right? They're gonna be like, no, I wanted this in the screen and this, or what does that button do, right? You start a conversation. And so it's not always about getting it right the first time, it's about getting the conversation going so that you can discover the information and answer the questions you didn't even know to ask. It's a great question. All right. Benjamin asks, question about certifications offered by the AABA. Are there a minimum number of hours of BA experience? There is a minimum number of hours of experience that are cited by both. Are those actual or recommendations? And how can I prove that I have those hours of experience? And what happens if it's not in a BA role? Excuse me. So my cough is mostly better. Just a little lingering. So it is a requirement, not a recommendation. And you are asked when you submit your application to either IIBA or PMI or wherever you're applying for to document your work history and align it to the standard body of knowledge. Excuse me. So that's how it works. And it does not have to be under the title. So it doesn't matter what the title is, it's were you doing the actual skills. And often when people go through our training, what they realize is that they've been doing this or doing these techniques kind of under a different name. Sometimes you can have the experience and not even realize you have the experience. And so it's really, that's where training is so important to really realize. Excuse me, to realize the depth of your experience, the relevance of your experience. All right, Priyanka says, that is so true. You got my pain. Thank you so much for giving me courage. You're welcome. Excuse me. All right. All right. So I have one last question that was sent ahead of time. And if you have any other questions, feel free to get them into the comments box. We've gone on for quite a while. Thank you all for hanging with me. This has been super fun. I know we're like in between evacuations and had a fun day with my girls, but like I love to talk about this stuff. So this is like a bright point in my day as well. All right. So it was, I think this is a different Priyanka than Priyanka here, where she said, I have experience working as a business analyst for a year. However, I feel that I would have applied these, if I would have applied the skills you listed in the course in my role, I would have had a better experience in that role and would have been more successful. So I'm not currently working. She's thinking of taking up the blueprint, which I'll talk about in a bit. How am I going to apply those skills? Like, how can I apply the skills if I'm not working? Is really the part of the question I want to answer here because this happens a lot. Like, great, Laura, you talked about all these different ways of applying experience and getting to the next level. I'm not employed. So aren't I just stuck where I am? And I've seen so many ways that this works. Okay. So, oh, it was you. Okay, good. Well, I'm glad that we get to talk about this one too. So, Todd is an example. Todd's case study just went up on the blog. He went back to his past employer and offered to do the business analysis work for free, which led him to paying contract work. So, you know, he knew that they were going through a merger. And that they, when you go through a merger, any kind of change like that, you need business analysis. And so he offered to do some for free. And that led to a paying opportunity for him. You know what? I am just going to go get a cough drop real quick because otherwise I am not going to finish this. I'll be right back. Hello, hello. All right. Thank you for your patience with me. All right. So Todd's example, I love that because a lot of a big thing when you're unemployed too is like getting some money coming in. That's important. And so his allowed him to expand his skill set and get some money coming in. And now he's talking about shaping a full BA contract role with that particular employer. Another example was Perry. So Perry was from the Jersey Islands in the UK, and he volunteered at a local charity. And he used that experience to get the skills and the experience. And like the thing about volunteering at a local charity that not everybody realizes is you can still speak to that in an interview situation. So when you go, and you can actually put it at the top of your resume too, because one of the challenges is that we feel like we have this gap in our resume, right? Especially as that most recent employment gets further and further back. So you don't have, there's no rule in your resume that what you have put on your resume is paid work, right? If you are working in that organization and you are doing business analysis, you can say business analysis for your local church, your local PTA, even a bigger nonprofit organization that might help that you could work for. So that is work experience that you can put on your resume, and now you have something front and center that represents you as a business analyst. So that's another example I would share with you. And then the final example is Amelia, who I've spoken to a lot. She was employed, but like even when you are employed, and she had the title of business analyst, and this is where like the role is so much more important than the title, right? And whether it's certification or whether it's what you're doing to get to the next level in your career, like she had the title, but she didn't have a lot of active projects, and she had things that kept kind of getting pulled out from underneath her, and so she couldn't actually do the work in her paid role. And she volunteered through her husband's organization. So he was the director of infrastructure and worked for his organization on some of the projects that they had. And again, volunteered her time. They actually offered to pay her though. So that kind of thing can actually lead to paying work. We had another person volunteer at her local pharmacy, and that led to a great reference locally. So doing a little bit of pro bono work, or in some cases, a lot of pro bono work, can help you get that experience. And it can also lead to opportunities that get you into the employment situation that you want. So that was the last question I think I had. Oh, and then I was going to talk a little bit more about the blueprint, but feel free if you have other questions to get them in. I can hang around for a few more minutes here. But so we are getting ready to open the blueprint training program where we walk through all of these skills in depth and teach you how to do them, give you training on how to do them, the swipe files, the templates, and a big part of what's included in our program is also the one-on-one instructor support. So you actually get to go do all of these things and get that work reviewed by an instructor. So we are opening registration on Monday, September 9th, and the course officially starts September 18th. That's like our official kickoff. But you get immediate access to a lot of the first set of materials. So there's some advantages to starting a little bit earlier. And we close registration on Tuesday, September 16th. So we just need that couple of days to make sure we have everybody in the right place and in the login, and there's just some support that happens in between there. So there's about a week to register from Monday, September 9th through Tuesday, September 16th. And I will be continuing to go live in the group over those weeks, talking, answering questions that you have still about the free training, about the blueprint, about the next step in your business analyst career. Super, super excited to get started with the enrollment process and bring people in. We do have, I think it's about 11 or 12 people who are pre-registered already, and we will be limiting, we limit the size of how many people we can bring in because we do actually provide one-on-one instructor support. So there's some reason to join early. If you know that you're going to join, definitely just be ready on Monday. And if you are on our free training list, you actually got a complete video walking through the entire program and all of the details about that program and what's included and who it's for and who it's not for. And that went out today. And if you haven't gotten that yet, go ahead to that free link that I posted in the comments, bridgingthegaps.com BridgingTheGap.com/free, and you'll get the free training that I've been talking about. And also I'll be, you'll get the free training and the, about the blueprint. Leslie, about how much the course costs, that is always the first question. And, you know, I'm, price is price, but really I want you to understand what's included first. So I will be talking about price as we go through here. There is a full pay option and a payment plan option. It's really an investment. So when we're thinking about like what we're choosing, it's like, how do I invest in me and getting to that next level of the career, in my career? And it would be kind of a disservice if I told you the price now without you getting to go through all of what's included in the program. And we do share the price in the about video that I mentioned. So that's not information that I'm hiding from you now. I just, it makes more sense in the context of the whole package. Sometimes when we hear prices, we can say, yes, that's for me, not, yes, that's not for me, or no, that's not for me. It's either too high or it's too low for whatever reason. And so it really needs to be framed up in the context of everything else. So that's all I have to share with you. I'm super excited to get started and to continue to be offering these sessions over the next few weeks. And if you have any other questions about where you're going in your next step in your career, let me know. Leslie says, awesome. I thought I missed it. Nope. It's all there. I promise. We're good. All right. So you have a great rest of your day. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your questions. As I always like to close, we build our profession one business analyst at a time. The profession of business analysis is so important. We have so many problems, so many challenges in our world today. We have so many changes to make that can make the world better. And you are the people who are making our world better for our next generation and the generations to come. So thank you for being here. We build our profession one business analyst at a time, and success starts with you. So thank you. Have a great night, everyone. Talk to you soon.